Thank you, Sandeep. The Shilahara team and friends, I'm planning to speak about the evolution of monolithic architecture and obviously keeping the Kailashanatha of Ellora in the center. I've been talking about Ellora and Kailashanatha quite repeatedly, but today I'm not going to focus on the sculpture at all. I'll be talking essentially about the monolithic architecture. And there is a specific reason for it, that this enigmatic colossus is being mystified to such an extent that people have almost ceased to look at it from a logical point of view. It is quite natural because it is perhaps the largest monolith in the world. And right from its creation, it is shrouded in the mystery. There is a copper plate which was issued in Gujarat by Karka Suvarna Varsha, barely about 150 years later than the creation of Kailashanatha. Now it is in the collection of the Oriental Institute of Baroda. That copper plate has two beautiful stanzas of poems. In one of the stanzas, it is said that the Shilpi who created Kailasha, he tried to repeat that feat and he failed and kept wondering, how could I do it? The second stanza says that when the gods were traveling through the sky, they looked at this monument and they kept wondering that how the human beings can create this. And finally, they came to a conclusion that perhaps Lord Shiva himself must have created it as his earthly abode. In the medieval literature, particularly in 13th century, Jnaneshwar, Chakradhar, Mahim Bhatt, they talk about this particular monument. Chakradhar and Mahim Bhatt, they speak precisely about this monument, but the famous poem of Jnaneshwara, which says, Chinseche Pani Eka Mandira Bandale, Adhi Kalasamaga Payare, a temple was built in which the Kalash was built first and then the foundation was done. I'm sure Jnaneshwar, who stayed a few kilometers away from Ellora at a place called Nevasa, must have certainly seen this monument. Chakradhar, the great Mahanubhav Sen, he stayed in this monument for about 5 months. And Mahim Bhatt, in his Sthanapoti, talks about this monument, and the discussion between them tell us very categorically that Chakradhar tells Mahim Bhatt that this stone, this mountain has been totally hollowed from within. And another reference shows that they noticed that it was an active Vamachari center in 13th century. The name of the monument is also quite enigmatic. The name which we use today, Kailashanatha Temple, is not used in the medieval literature. It is referred to as Manakeshwarache Lene. And in the other stories, this particular place is known as Ela Purachala. Even the gods who are traveling through the sky, in that Siddhamshi poem, it says Ela Purachala Chalagata Nirisannivesha. So either Elapura or Eluru is the original name of this particular place. The patronage of this monument is also quite debatable. Some people attribute it to Dantidurga, the first sovereign king of Rashtrakuta dynasty. Some believe that it has been excavated by his uncle who inherited this kingdom. Even the Siddhamshi copper plate talks about Krishna as the patron of this monument. The latest, some people believe that it is not possible for a single patron to finish such an ambitious monument. And that is why they think that the later Rashtrakutas also must have contributed to it. So there are various views about everything. Kathakalpataru, a medieval story, it talks about, a medieval text, talks about a very interesting story of a king called Eluraja. Eluraja was suffering from a very curious skin disease. He used to be all right in the daytime, but at night he suffered from a very severe skin disease. So his wife, she begged to Lord Shiva that if Eluraja gets cured, she will build a temple for Shiva. And unless she sees the shikhar of that temple, she would not even accept a drop of water. Eventually, Eluraja was cured, but then the other problem occurred, because the kind of temple which she had promised would have taken a few months to be built, and she cannot be starved for so many, for such a long time. At that juncture, a sculptor called Kokasa came to her rescue. He offered to the king that he can do this job in a couple of days' time. And he started carving the temple from the top. He carved the shikara first, asked the queen to do the darshan, and then the rest of the temple was carved. Now, this myth is very interesting. Whether it is true or not is not very important. But the most important thing is, in 15th century, people were aware that this temple is carved from top to bottom. Now, this Kokasa is also a mysterious figure. This name occurs in medieval literature so many times. We do not know whether it was a family of sculptors or a single sculptor, but his name occurs in different times, and that is why we do not know who exactly he was. He must be some mysterious master who has been mythified in the later period. Let's try to give a thought to this possibility also. When let's come to the monument, which is the largest monolith in the world. Now, the technology, carving a monolith from living rock, and the kind of technology that prevailed in that time. Now, both these things do not really convince people that such a monument can be carved only with chisels and hammers. That is why people keep talking about various theories. But the people who try to look at it from a more objective point of view have also committed some very, very, very grave mistakes. Even some great scholars like Burgess and Ferguson or Walter Spink, they propose that while carving this monument, a huge trench was carved in the living mountain. The central block was separated from the rest of the mountain, and then the temple was carved in that central block. We'll talk about this theory when the time comes, but this theory doesn't hold much of a merit. About chronology, where exactly is to be kept and for how long this work went on. Some people believe, particularly the people who do not know much about Indian history, they think that this work must have gone on for thousands of years, which it did not. It seems that the actual temple, the shrine proper, I'm not talking about the caves around the temple, the shrine proper must not have taken more than 25 to 30 years. And that is why it can be split between two rules, the rule of Dantidurga and the rule of Krishna. The architectural style and the lineages is also a matter of discussion, because the architecture is not local architecture. It obviously is a grand example of South Indian or Dravida architecture. So we will have to trace the lineages of this architecture, and we will also have to examine whether it solely depends on the lineages or it also adds something of its own. That is one more thing which we will have to discuss. The most fascinating thing is who visualized this monument. When I saw it for the first time, the thought that came to my mind that the person who thought about this monument, the person who ventured to actually materialize this monument, and the person who patronized it, all three of them must have been really crazy. No sane person would ever think about this kind of a monument. It is unbelievable. I don't know what gave them the ideas to carve a monolith from on such a scale. Who exactly are the predecessors of these ideas, and which are the predecessors of this monolith? That is also a question that needs to be addressed. And the last question is, why did they think about carving a monolith when there was already a great tradition of cave architecture? There are Pashupata caves at Ellora itself. There are Shaivite caves, there are Vaishnavite caves. And if this tradition was still alive, why did they think of carving a monolith? There must be some reason behind it. So these are the questions which are on the anvil, and we'll have to address them one by one. So let's go back to the rock cut architecture tradition. If we see the inaugural phase of rock cut architecture, it is essentially Buddhist. We know, all of you know, that the earliest known cave is the Lomas Rishi cave in Barabar Hills. Then another cave which is almost contemporaneous to that is the Guntupalli cave. There are caves in Maharashtra, Kondivte, which could be very early. Thanala, Narsur, Bhaja, Kondane, Pitalkora can go back to 2nd century BC. So right from 3rd century BC to 2nd century BC, there was a lot of cave architecture activity, but it was particularly Buddhist activity. The Hindu caves started sometime in 4th century or so. Ramgarh is one of the earliest known Brahmanical caves. But here, the departure which we see in cave architecture is from the upsidal Chaitya. The Hindu cave architecture, they abandoned the upsidal Chaitya. But if you see the caves at Udaygiri, keep aside Ramgarh. Ramgarh doesn't show these characters. Udaygiri, Jogeshwari, Ellora, Badami, Aiholi, all these caves have a large hall which is attached with a small chamber or garbhagriha. So if we go to Ajanta, the vihara with a chapel is already a plan which was in vogue. So this is not a new plan, this is not a new idea. A hall with a chapel, a hall with a chamber is already prevailing in Buddhist architecture. And these early cave temples of Hindus follow the same ground plan. There's nothing drastically different from this ground plan in the early Hindu architecture. The first major innovation that can be seen in cave architecture is in the Pashupata caves. The Pashupata caves, particularly at places like Jogeshwari, Elephanta, and later the Dumarlena cave, cave number 29 of Ellora. These caves have the Garbhagriha in somewhere in between. It is called Sarvato Bhadra Garbhagriha. A Garbhagriha with four doors on four cardinal directions. Now, and if you see the Hindu cave architecture in Andhra Desha and Tamil Nadu, there also you will find some differences. Let's try to see them. This is Elephanta, and we know this is a Pashupata cave attributed to Kalachuri. And here you can see that the Garbhagriha, since Shivalinga, unlike the other images of gods and goddesses, does not have frontality. If you want to worship any other image, you will have to worship it from the front. But Shivalinga doesn't have a front. It can be worshipped from any direction. And that is why in this Garbhagriha, you can see doors on all four cardinal directions. This Sarvatobhadra Garbhagriha is the first major departure from the Buddhist cave architecture that we see in the Pashupata caves. If you go further towards south, cave temples were not new in Maharashtra. They were not new in Karnataka also. In Chalukyan time, they have already started. But it seems that in Andhra Desha, they started in the times of Vishnu Pundits. And there is a cluster of caves near Vijayawada. This place is known as Mughal Rajpuram, which is a part of Vijayawada city today. Now, these caves are slightly different than the ones which we saw before. Most of these caves have more than one Garbhagriha. That is a different feature of these caves. And what we see, a very distinct feature of these caves, are the Dwarapalas. They are also called Pratiharas. And I call them Veera Pratiharas because unlike the Pratiharas which we saw in the caves in Maharashtra, which are almost a three-dimensional translation of Padmapani, Vajrapani, Avalokiteshwar, very docile, very contemplative, very engrossed in themselves. Instead, we can see a very aggressive, very assertive Dwarapala in Andhra Desh. They are wearing a mukut with a pair of horns, very unusual. We go further to Tamil land, and in Tiruchirappalli, we come across a very interesting cave, which was carved by Mahendra Varman, Lalitankura Mahendra Varman, the first major Pallava ruler. This is called Lower Tiruchirappalli Cave. And in this cave, there are so many inscriptions. You can see that the same pair of Dwarapalas can be seen here also, in this cave. And the image, which is a very imposing image of Shiva Gangadhara. Now you know that Shiva Gangadhara is a proclamation of power. Ganges wanted to jump down to the earth. She agreed to come to the earth, but she challenged Bhagiratha that how the earth can bear her thrust. And at that juncture, Bhagiratha requested Shiva to bear the brunt. And Ganga tried to be a little naughty with Shiva. She tried to push him down, and Shiva very easily locked her up in his jata. You can see that particular picture over here. Now, this is the picture, this is the depiction of the might of Shiva. Mahendravarman is equating himself with Shiva, and in these inscriptions, he talks about his might. He very proudly talks about his military deeds and says that he is conquering the Dakshina Ganga, that is Kaveri, which flows close to Tiruchirappalli. Now, this inscription says that for the first time, he is building a temple for his god, which is not built of mortar, bricks, or wood. So he is almost claiming that a new technique of temple architecture is being introduced over here. It is not used before. This is very, which means that there is no tradition of cave architecture in Tamil Nadu. And if you actually see the archaeological remains, we realize that Mandakapattu, the Lakshitayana of Mandakapattu, Mamandur, Tiruchirappalli are the earliest caves in the Tamil land. There is no cave architecture before this. Mahendravarman's claim of introducing the cave architecture to Tamil land is quite a justified claim. Which means that the earlier examples of cave architecture in this region are found in Andhra region, and Tamil Nadu borrows this tradition further. Probably because Mahendravarman also has matrimonial relations. His maternal uncle comes from the Vishnukundan family. So the Lower Akanna Madana caves, the Undavalli caves, all these caves are the predecessors of the Pallava cave architecture. Now here at this juncture, I want to bring in a very interesting find, which I worked on about 20 years back. When I was working on Ellora for my doctoral thesis, I found an inscription at a place called Bokardan, which is 60 kilometers away from Ellora. It has a very curious insignia, which looks like a battle axe, and a small legend, which reads Sri Utpatti Pidugu. Sri Utpatti Pidugu literally would mean the creative thunderbolt. I felt that it must be a name of a sculptor's guild, which must have traveled to Bokardan. Because the same inscription has been found in the cave which we saw earlier, the Akanna Madanna cave, the Undavalli cave. So a group of sculptors, the guild of sculptors, must have traveled from Andhra Desha to Bokardan. And I was always curious that on the way, they must have carved some other monuments also. So when we could find time, we traveled, me and my younger colleagues, including Jairam Poduval, We tried to create a road, we tried to imagine a road, and we actually traveled in a jeep on that road, and we could find 29 monuments which can be attributed to this particular group. Nine of them have inscriptions, the rest of them can be attributed to them on stylistic grounds. But when I started working further on this, I realized that it is not a guild of creative artists, it is some religious leader who is leading an activity of Hindu revival. Normally, the revivalism of Hinduism is credited to Shankaracharya. But it seems that the process has started much earlier. Shankaracharya perhaps is at the helm of that movement. But it started much earlier, and we know that Kumar Ilavatta also is responsible for it. The rise of Smartha philosophy in 5th, 6th century perhaps can be considered as the inspiration of this revival. We know Gaudapada, a very important scholar and Shankaracharya's guru. He is also responsible for all these developments, and Utpatti Pidugu must be one of the saints from this tradition in the pre-Shankara developments. He must be one of the followers of Kumarila. And perhaps, we are not very sure, Kumarila could be, there is a big controversy about the date of Kumarila. In some of the stories, we come to know that Shankaracharya met Kumarila. We do not want to go into all those details at this juncture. They can be discussed independently. What I'm trying to bring home is Kumarila perhaps is the guru of Mahendravarman. And in Mahendravarman's period, you can see the beginning of this revival. This monolithic architecture, now when they started monolithic architecture, these people who are working towards the revival of Hinduism, they wanted something to be branded as Hindu architecture. which is different than the cave architecture of the Buddhists. And perhaps superstructure, the prasada, the famsana, which is considered as the salient feature of Hindu architecture, they wanted that particular feature in cave architecture also. They are perhaps looking at superstructure as the identity of Hinduism. This is being recognized as the Hindu identity. And you can see these attempts for the first time in the lower Akkanna Madanna cave of Vijayawada. Akkanna Madanna is the new name. We need not go by that name. But this lower Akkanna Madanna cave is perhaps the first attempt towards carving a monolith, a monolithic superstructure. But it is an aborted monolith. It is a failure. Let's see what exactly has happened over there. This is another view of the same monolith, which they have tried to carve from the front. And this monolith failed, probably because they did not know how to handle a monolith. If you observe this structure very carefully, you will realize that this portion is the finished portion. So they must have started carving this monolith from bottom and they tried to go towards the top. Naturally, that is not the right way of carving a monolith. They could not handle it further. This got aborted, this failed, this attempt failed, probably because of the upward carving. So this is the first failed attempt of carving a monolith found in Vijayawada. As we go further, there is a place called Undavali right across the river Godavari, hardly 15-20 kilometers from Vijayawada. There is a huge cave, but along with those caves, there are a couple of small monoliths which they have attempted. And this particular monolith, they have tried to carve from the front. Initially, they tried to carve from bottom to top. Now, perhaps they are trying to carve it from the front. And again, these attempts also failed. They could not succeed in carving a monolith. There is another example. There are three examples in this place, Undavali Caves. Undavali Caves are very interesting. M.S. Mate has written a very interesting architect. Gio Dubruil has written on Undavali. All of the people who have visited Undavali find this monument a very curious, very mysterious monument. Here, you can see that they started carving from the front and perhaps did not know what to do with it. They wanted to go around it. There is no space over here and it is not possible to go around when you start carving from the front. This attempt is still more ambitious and they almost managed to do it. You can enter into this place. It is a multi-storied cave and you can see that they started from the top, but it is front and top. So they could carve a multi-storied cave, but again, they could not separate this structure from the rest of the mountain. It is a very deep carving, but it is not separated. The attempt is there. You can see the attempt of separating this from the rest of the mountain, but they failed to do it. Again, now see, when we see Ellora, Kailashnath has not come from the blues. It hasn't emerged right at that place. There are so many efforts which have failed earlier. And then after all these efforts, they finally succeeded in carving. There is a controversy about the date of this cave. Some people keep it in 6th century, some people keep it in 7th century. Kharosa is a place near Killari. Killari is known for a bad reason. That was the epicenter of that deadly earthquake that took place in Maharashtra. This place, Kharosa, is hardly 5 kilometers away from Killari. There is a complex of 20 caves in Kharosa, and there are some very small monoliths which they have attempted to carve in this place. But the bigger monolith which they have attempted, again, is a failure. Kharosa caves are incomplete. The stone is quite bad. The skill, it is very interesting that all these early efforts divulge the poverty of skills of the people. All these non pre-imperial Rashtrakuta monuments, they are not handled by very skillful people, probably because this Utpatti Pidugu was not a very eminent group. It was not a group of very eminent artists. They were charged with a mission, but they did not have the skill to fulfill that mission. So whatever they are like pioneers, and whatever they tried has been exploited by other people at a later juncture. And perhaps this is the first time that a successful monolith has been carved. These are Ramling caves at Palsambe. They are in the riverbed near Kolhapur, about 30-40 kilometers from Kolhapur. And Shilahar Foundation organized a lecture on this. It was a small presentation by Dr. Yogesh Prabhudesai, and he showed some very good slides of this particular monument. So these small monoliths, successfully carved monoliths, are found for the first time in the riverbed of Palsambe. He placed it in 6th century, but I think they may not be earlier than 7th century, or perhaps later half of 7th century. But again, let's not forget that these caves are not carved from living mountain. These are huge boulders in the bed of the river, and perhaps those boulders inspired the sculptors to carve a monolith from it. But what we observe here is very important for one reason, that these monoliths are perfect examples of Dravida architecture, which means that the Dravida architecture is already crystallized to some extent, and the same iconography is being imitated over here. You can see the stupi on top of it. You can see the karnakutas. You can see the panjaras. So the kapota is there, though not very crystallized, but the features of Dravida architecture can be seen over here. So now perhaps they are happy with their success that they managed to carve a monolith. We do not know whether the same sculptors went to other places and tried to do the similar things. In India, it is very curious that the technology keeps ramifying to different places. Even the iconography is shared so quickly in different parts of the country. Something which is discovered in Nepal reaches Karnataka in a period of a couple of decades. This is very interesting, and we do not know how exactly did these things travel. We can see the same technology traveling to the southern part of the country. These are two more examples. Now here I want to make one more important point, that I would very confidently, without any doubt, attribute this monument, this group of monoliths, to Utpatti Pidugu. And I have not studied it very carefully, but I am very hopeful to find the Utpatti Pidugu insignia on one of these monoliths. I'm very hopeful. I'll check it. But what I'm trying to bring home at this juncture is, these are the pioneers. These are the people who tried different possibilities. They are not the masters. And there is always a difference between a pioneer and a master. The pioneer is an explorer. The pioneer is a courageous person. The pioneer is a person who doesn't hesitate to face failure. He can venture into various failures. And that is why he is the person who shows the way. Master is the person who exploits that knowledge further and finally reaches the successful. So masters are successful, pioneers may not be. Now here you can see a master, the Arjuna Ratha and the Dharmaraja Ratha of Mahabalipuram, where you can see a perfectly crystallized Dravida Vimana with Karnakuta, Shalakuta, Panjara, Kapota, and this octagonal stupi on top of it. A beautiful monolith. But this is a deceptive monolith. It is a pseudo monolith because it is a solid monolith. You cannot enter into it. Barring some shallow niches, these are not temples in the real sense. They could imitate a Dravida structure, but they could not create a Dravida structure. But it is very beautifully created. So here you can see the first attempt to carve a proper superstructure in the Dravida tradition from a boulder. Not again, let's not forget that it is not a living rock. It is a boulder, a loose boulder, a huge boulder perhaps, which was cut into pieces, and these monuments were created from that boulder. This perhaps is the first successful monolith carved from the living mountain. When these things were happening, now these sculptors who were working in different parts of the country, the Pallava sculptors, the Chalukyan sculptors, very eminent sculptors, very proficient sculptors, they were perhaps in search of work. And we know that Dantidurga was the vassal of Chalukyas. He declared his sovereignty in the second half, in the toward the end of first half of 8th century. And then at that juncture, perhaps he wanted to proclaim his power, to proclaim his might. And he must have started thinking about an ambitious monument. We do not know. We are trying to build up a story. But without building up a story, without building a building up a hypothesis, we cannot visualize the picture. Here, you can see that a very simple monolith has been carved. And for the first time, the sculptors realized that the monolith has to be separated from the living mountain and then carved. So here you can see that it is delinked from the rest of the mountain. And then they were not interested in carving a very elaborate monolith over here. They only wanted to check the possibility of carving a monolith, which they successfully handled. And now we'll go further to cave number 50, the Dashavatara cave. This is popularly known as Nandi Mandapa, on which you find the inscription of Dantidurga. Dantidurga has visited this place, but he doesn't say that he is responsible for this cave. Now, it is very interesting that this cave originally is a Buddhist cave. We know this because there are images of seated Buddha on the upper facade, on the pillars of the upper facade. There is a row of seated Buddha images. The architecture is exactly like the architecture of cave number 11 and cave number 12. 11 and 12 are three-storied caves. This is a two-storied cave. And as we know that the cave has to be started, has to be carved from top to bottom, the topmost story was the first story. The second story is the lower story. And the third story, that is the bottom story, is yet to be carved. Naturally, this cave is at a height. The original plan must be reached the ground level after carving the third story. Probably because the waning patronage, the Buddhist activity at Ellora came to a standstill. There is enough evidence to say this, that it seems that the Ellora Buddhist activity started very impetuously, but at some juncture in 6th century, it came to a very meager activity. And then in 7th, 8th century, it almost came to a standstill. This incomplete cave perhaps has been taken over by those carvers who were invited to think about the ambitious monument of Kailashnath. Cave number 15 is a laboratory. All the sculptures, if you go to the upper story of cave number 15, the sculptures are extremely inconsistent. There are at least 4 to 5 different guilds working on the sculptures, which means that several people from several places were invited to work at cave number 15, and some of them perhaps were selected to work on Kailashnath. So here, this boulder must be lying unattended, and they tried to carve a monolith for the first time from that boulder. Let's see it from the other side. The people who are conversant with patriarchal architecture, Virupaksha temple, they will immediately notice that this is almost a copy of Virupaksha temple. So the Chalukya carvers must have worked on it. The Udgamas, the Sopanas, the pilasters, the walls, everything, even the ceiling, very similar to patriarchal architecture. The only difference is it is carved from a living rock. So try to imagine that all these portions, the two stories of the cave on this side are complete, and this huge boulder is uncarved, which is yet to be removed. They must have thought of carving a monolith from this boulder because they knew how to carve a monolith from a boulder. But they didn't know what to carve. The only challenge they had was to enter into this monolith, which they successfully did. And they also carved the windows. This, I would say, is the first complete successful monolith in the history of Indian monolith architecture. This is the beginning of the real monolithic architecture. Now you can see that the height of the mountain the temple cannot exceed the height of the mountain because it is carved from the mountain, right? So for the boulder, this passage was already there for the carvers to reach the caves from both the sides. This boulder was lying over there, which they would have removed later on, because removing the boulder is a different technique. This is the Virupaksha temple. Now we come to the thing which we really want to study. This is Virupaksha of Pattadakal. The date of construction goes back to 733 to 745. There is an inscription. You know that the Chalukya king, queens, they built these two temples to celebrate the victory of their husband. And in an inscription which is found in the premises of this temple, we come across two names. One is Sarvasiddhi Acharya and the other is Gundacharya. Now, this is something very interesting. The name of the artist, the name of the architect is mentioned over here. Let's go a little further south. This is Kailasanathara temple of Kanchipuram. The date of this temple is 685 to 705, even earlier than Virupaksha Pattadakal. Now it is very interesting that somewhere Kannada land, we find at a place called Peddavaduguru, we come across an inscription which says that a Pallava Acharya came from Kanchi to Karnataka. Now this is very interesting. See the superstructure of Kanchi Kailashanatha and the superstructure of Virupaksha, which is very similar to each other. So it is quite possible that the Sarvasiddhi Acharya, who is mentioned in Virupaksha temple, must be the Acharya who traveled from Kanchi to Virupaksha temple. And the other person who worked over the local Acharya could be Gundacharya. This Peddavaduguru inscription is very, very important. Now, the monument which we have been talking about and we did not see at all, the Kailashanatha of Ellora on the right. It obviously is a Dravida Vimana, obviously is derived from the Dravida architecture, and there is a big controversy about the predecessor of this monolith. Some people are of the opinion that it imitates or it follows the Virupaksha temple of Pattadakal as its model. Some people attribute it to Kanchipuram temple. But if you see it carefully, you will notice that it doesn't follow any of them. The South Indian iconography of Vimana is not faithfully followed in this monument. The Karnakutas are merged with the main structure. They do not stand distinct as they should in this monument. The Shalakuta, you can see the remains of Shalakuta, but again, that has been pressed into the superstructure. So here, all these elements, modelings are pushed into the main structure, and a huge Shukadasa emerges from the front. Very curious structure. Unlike the South Indian structure, you can see the Devakoshtha, Bhadrakoshtha. So it doesn't have similarity with the Tamila superstructure. It doesn't show similarity. Well, similarity is there, but it is not a direct simulation of these structures which we are talking about. This is Virupaksha. This is Kailashanatha. You can see the difference in the stupi. You can see the of course, unlike Kanchipuram, the verticality of Virupaksha is imitated over here. So obviously there is some similarity with Kanchipuram, there is some similarity with Virupaksha temple. So who exactly must have visualized this? Is it the architect of Kailashanatha or is it the architecture of Virupaksha temple or some other? Because since there was a tradition of cave architecture or rock architecture in Maharashtra, It is difficult to believe that the whole work was handed over to the people who came from outside. There must be some contribution of the local craftsmen, because the local craftsmen have shown their worth in the earlier caves. They have carved some very ambitious caves like cave number 11 and 12, cave number 10. So is it possible that legendary Kokas, whose name keeps appearing again and again, so was there a local person who visualized something so ambitious and invited people from outside to help him? Because the work is so ambitious that it cannot be handled by a single guild. He needs help from the other guilds. So naturally, the people who are more proficient with architecture, he must have invited people from outside, and probably Gunda Anvaritachari and his guild, along with the other Acharya Sarvasiddhi, were invited to help these local guilds. Again, we are imagining things, but without imagining, it is not possible to fathom the creative process of this monolith. It is so enigmatic that we will have to set our imagination free to understand this mystery, to fathom this mystery. The name of Revadi Ovajja is also found in Karnataka inscriptions, a great sculptor. All these people, it is quite possible, because if you see the sculptural style of Kailashanath temple and cave number 15, it is exactly in continuation of Patadakal sculpture. I'm more than sure that the person from Patadakal has worked on the upper register of Kailashanath temple and on some of the sculptures from cave number 15. There's no doubt about it. And in my recent book, we have discussed about it. We have discussed these things in details. So these people, this synthesis is very important. People from three different traditions are coming over here. Now see why I'm talking about a third master. Neither Gundacharya nor Sarvasiddhi Acharya, because this is Kanchipuram, the Kailashanatha of Kanchipuram. You can see that the Garbhagriha is attached with seven sub-shrines. Normally, we talk about the Panchayatan. In Smartha philosophy, there are Panchayatan, the Ishtadevata in the center, and the other cardinal gods and goddesses, four other. Here you can see the seven shrines. This is Virupaksha temple. The sub-shrines are not in the same position, but there are several sub-shrines in this temple. Here, the Saptayatana, and here the Navaranga Mandapa. The Mandapa here is divided with a row of pillars with a central nave and two aisles. As against that, in Virupaksha temple, you can see the Mandapa is being divided in nine equal squares with four sets of four pillars. This is called a Navaranga Mandapa. Now let's see the plan of Kailashanatha. And you can immediately notice that the Saptayatana of Kanchipuram and the Navaranga Mandapa of Virupaksha temple has been grafted together in this structure. So these two traditions, somebody is collapsing these two traditions together, perhaps a third person. He is using two great structures to create the third structure, and he supplements it with so many other ambitious structures. So this is the possibility which we can think about. So it is a beautiful collapse of the Saptayatana Garbhagriha and the Navaranga Mandapa. You can see it from here. This is the Navaranga Mandapa with very ambitious Mukha Mandapas and Ardha Mandapas, and a Mukha Mandapa with a Nandi Mandapa and Gopur. What an ambitious plan. The person who visualized it must have seen this temple before it was carved. I'm reminded of that statement of Michelangelo. Michelangelo was asked about David, how did you carve it? He said he was already there in the stone. I only removed those portions which were not David. The same thing has happened over there. The Kailasha was always here. The rest of the things were carved out. Now we'll come back to the trench theory, which people talk about. This is the trench which they talk about, this portion. So what they are trying to say that this block, rectangular block, was separated from the living mountain by carving these trenches, and then the temple was carved in the central block. Now try to imagine separating this block and reaching right up to this depth. Now how do they remove the boulders from this level and throw them out? Carving a trench of 100 feet depth and 200 feet length is not a joke. It is practically impossible. So the trench theory is extremely impractical, extremely illogical. They started carving right from the top and reached on all the four sides. That is the only way a monolith can be carved. There is no other way of carving a monolith. This is how they started. This is the living mountain. They dressed the mountain like this. Then perhaps on that portion, which was a rectangular portion, they made a drawing where the Shikhara would come, where the Nandi Mandapa would come, where the Mukha Mandapas will come. All those things were drawn. And then they started carving from this point. So gradually they came down. And this portion was carved at the end. This portion, these are the last carvings of this excavation. They went around the Shikhara while carving. They came down in layers and they went around it. These caves are later additions. Perhaps this one is not. Let's talk about it. Because there is one more theory that the Pitha is an afterthought. You must have noticed that this is the only temple which has a huge Pitha of about 25-30 feet. And they say that this is extremely illogical, and there are some caves in the upper register which are incomplete and which do not have access today. There is one more argument which is given, that there was a bridge which is broken. Can you see this? Which is broken today, which connects the other part of the cave. And perhaps that is the original level, and this portion was added much later after the collapse of this bridge. Now, if the original level was here, why did they need the bridge? That is one thing. The other interesting thing is Gary Tartakov talks about the Prathameshtaka ceremony. He says that there is a ceremony when the monument is started, laying down the first brick. Now, there is no question of laying a brick in Kailashnatha because it is not a structural temple. But that Prathameshtaka ceremony was perhaps conducted in this portion. And to connect this the ceremonial ground with the rest of the temple, they must have built this bridge. That is the possibility I can suggest. I very confidently can say that this pillar, now imagine if the temple would have been only up to this level, how the pillar would have been. The pillar is a complete structure, and in cave architecture, you cannot add anything from above. It has to be carved from the living rock. So naturally, this pillar was the part of the original design. You can see similar pillars here also. The proportions are also exactly the same, which means that right from the beginning, the monolith was conceived as a monolith with this huge pitha. Otherwise, it would have sunk in the rocks around. Without this pitha, this monolith would not survive. It would not hold its grandeur. This pillar is a very obvious evidence of the fact that Kailashnatha was conceived as a two-storied building, not a single-storied temple. Pitha is not an afterthought. Pitha is the part of the original design. Now, the monolithic tradition doesn't stop there. Once they discovered this technique, they continued with this technique. There is a place called Chota Kailash, which is cave number 30. And there also, you can see the same technique being employed. The size is much smaller. I have a strong contention that the poem which we find on the copper plate of Siddhamshi, which says that the sculptor tried to carve it again, and failed, I'm sure this must be the inspiration of that poet. The poet must have seen this monolith, and after seeing this, he must have thought that the sculptor tried it again because it is exactly like the original structure. And since he could not do it, that his imagination must have inspired that poem that the feat could not be repeated. You can see it is exactly the same. Even these cultures, the people who have visited Kailashanatha temple would immediately notice that these sculptures are also are imitated from the walls of Kailasha. These moldings on the corner, the huge kapota, the pillar types, everything comes from Kailasha. The only thing is Kailasha is of colossal order, where the pillars run through two stories at a time. And this is a single story structure. Imagine Kailasha, if Kailashanatha would have been a single story structure, it would have looked like this. And it would have been at this height. Now, one more interesting factor. Actually, I must thank my student to remind me about this structure. In my actual presentation, I did not include this structure. This is Vettuvan Koil, which is a Pandya monument, datable to late 8th century or 9th century. It is known as Kalugumalai. It is at Kalugumalai, known as Vettuvan Koil. You can immediately notice so many similarities between Kailashanath temple and this temple. Now, what are we trying to derive from this? The sculptors of Kailashanath came to Kalugumalai after that. I think that after discovering the technique of carving the monoliths in the Pallava region, some people straight away came to Tamil Nadu, the lower part of Tamil Nadu, from Mamallapuram. Some people traveled to Maharashtra. So there is a movement that can be traced from Kanchi to Pathadakal to Ellora. And so this is where the technicians of monolith architecture are being accompanied by the designers of Kanchipuram and Pathadakal. They traveled to Ellora, and another group, they straight away came from Mamallapuram to Kalugumalai. So these are two teams traveling towards north and another team traveling towards south. Some more details of the structure. It is an incomplete structure. Can see the sophistication is far more than the Kailashanath of Ellora. As I said, that the iconography of superstructure is very carefully followed over here. The moldings are very crisply carved, unlike the muddled up moldings of Kailashanath. The Kailashanath moldings are literally muddled up. You can hardly see the details. And one of the reasons could be, it is quite possible that the Kailashanatha of Ellora was covered with Vajralepa. We can see that Vajralepa in some of the places. In some places, it is a later addition, but even the original Vajralepa is visible in many places in Ellora. So it is quite possible that all the details were on the Vajralepa, not on the original carving. Gnaneshwar, in one of his poems, talks about Ki Kailasu Parade Thavarila, as if Kailasha is smeared with mercury. I think he must have seen that Kailasha with Vajralepa. We do not know how it must have looked. But anyway, what I was trying to say is all those moldings which are not carved very crisply in Kailashanatha can be seen carved very carefully in this particular temple. The rest of the portion, this also has a Navranga Mandapa, a very small Navranga Mandapa though, and some beautiful figures. We come back to Ellora again. This is slightly later, can be placed in late 10th and 11th century. popularly known as Indra Sabha. This is the Jain cave. Again, the same thing which I was trying to bring home, that the slope of the mountain, initially the slope was dressed and then the carving started from here. Went all around. This pillar is not a monolithic pillar. This is a structural pillar. You can see the kudu is getting more and more prominent now. It is hiding the shalakuta. So it looks more like a Vamsana structure. But this is a Jain structure, and probably that is why they're trying to do something distinctly different than the Brahmanical structure which we saw earlier. This is a different. Now Sarvatobhadrika is a Jain concept also, like the Pashupatas. The Jains also believe in Sarvatobhadrika, and what we see earlier here, this is a Sarvatobhadrika where you can see the Tirthankara facing all the directions. The same Sarvatobhadra structure here. The tradition of monolith architecture traveled outside Maharashtra also. It traveled during the reign of Rashtrakutas and perhaps after the reign of Rashtrakutas also, we do not know. After 10th, 11th century, it seems that the monolithic architecture, rather the cave architecture in general, came to a standstill. The structural temples continued. The Kolavi caves in Rajasthan have hollow stupa-like structures. Not very exciting. But a small structure at Vasavi, a place very close to Indore, has a beautiful example of a very, very modest, very tiny monolith, which has some very curious culture on top of it. These lions are very similar to Kailashanatha temple, but this dead or sleeping elephant, the purpose of showing this dead or sleeping elephant is not very clear. It is an incomplete structure. But another structure, Dumnar, which is near Mandsaur, is a successful monolith carved in Nagara style. Here you can see that the ground plan is almost similar. This too is a Saptayatana, like Kailashanatha, with a Navaranga Mandapa, a square Mandapa. But the superstructure is Nagara structure. Very interesting. Now this is a northern counterpart of the Kailashanath of Ellora. This too is a Rashtrakuta monument, because in this area we have come across a couple of Rashtrakuta inscriptions. Bhanpura has a Rashtrakuta inscription, Indragad has a Rashtrakuta inscription. And we know that the Gurjar Pratyaharas and the Rashtrakutas were at war all the time, and they were pushing the boundaries consistently. So the Rashtrakutas seems to have entered into this region. Masroor perhaps is the last major monolith that we can talk about. This is in Kangra. So the monolithic architecture which starts in Andhra Desha gradually evolves in Andhra Pradesh, in some parts of Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu, and reaches its zenith at Kailashanath temple. It tries, carving a monolith must be a very, very testing challenge. And probably that is why this particular style of architecture, at least on a very ambitious scale, did not continue. There are some stray examples as we saw them. And after this, this tradition, a great monument, a breathtaking monument. It seems that this particular tradition was discovered, was experimented with, was perfected only to carve that great monolith, which became an epitome of monolithic architecture and the Rashtrakuta architecture. Rashtrakutas, though it was a very powerful dynasty, they do not seem to have contributed very significantly to art and architecture. But this single monument of Rashtrakutas compensates all their lackings in the field of art patronage. Thank you very much.